Thinking back to when I studied audio production in college, I remember my professor walking the class step by step through the process of turning the stairwell down the hall into a reverb chamber. I learned so much from that experience, and in this video, I want to share that experience with you. But if you're new to this channel, my name is Kyle. You can learn audio production online by checking out the weekly videos I post to the Audio University YouTube channel. Learn more at audiouniversityonline.com. Making your own chamber reverb isn't just a way to get a one-of-a-kind reverb sound. It's also one of the best exercises for improving your understanding of how reverb works and how to integrate it into a mix. This video is inspired by Alex Case, a professor of sound recording technology at the University of Massachusetts Lowell. If you're a student of audio production, I strongly recommend that you check out Professor Case's Chamber Reverb Challenge. You can join the challenge for free at chamberreverbchallenge.com. At this website, you'll also find a ton of great information about reverb, absolutely free. Let's take a look at what the site has to offer and make our own chamber reverb. A basic chamber reverb consists of the following components: a signal, a reverberant space, a loudspeaker within the space to play the signal, and a microphone within the space to capture the sound of the loudspeaker, including the sound reflected from the surfaces in the space. In most cases, we'll set up a reverb on an effects send. We'll start with the original dry signal. Using an aux send in our DAW or on our mixer, we'll route the dry signal to the loudspeaker in the reverberant space. The sound will play from the loudspeaker, reflect off of the surfaces in the space, and eventually reach the microphone. The sound from the microphone is called the wet signal. We'll route the wet signal from the microphone into another channel on the console or the DAW. And now we have the dry signal on one channel and the wet signal on another channel. Let's start by choosing a space that will provide us with a pleasing reverb sound. When choosing the space for your chamber reverb, there are a few key characteristics to keep in mind, which you can find at chamberreverbchallenge.com/createyourchamber. First, we'll be looking for a space with highly reflective surfaces. This could be concrete, brick, glass, tile, or really any other hard surface. Ideally, we'll find a space that's irregularly shaped so that the sound can diffuse through the space rather than resonating only in certain areas. Look for a space with stairs, columns, bookshelves, or other non-parallel surfaces. It's important to choose a space that's quiet. Any noise in the space will be recorded as a part of your wet reverb signal and will eventually be added to your final mix. It may be in your best interest to record at nighttime so that you can avoid noise from nearby streets or neighbors. And finally, keep in mind this general principle. The larger the space, the more reverberant the space. On the Chamber Reverb Challenge website, you'll find a list of potential candidates for spaces that you might use. Each space in your house will have pros and cons when it comes to acting as a reverb chamber. Once you've decided on the space you'll use for your chamber reverb, it's time to select and set up the loudspeaker and the microphone. When selecting a loudspeaker, it's important to choose one that's capable of energizing the entire space with sound. Be sure not to overdrive your speaker in an effort to make it louder. The idea is to minimize the direct signal from the loudspeaker to the microphone. To accomplish this, you might choose a directional loudspeaker and a directional microphone and point them away from one another. You might even choose to use obstacles or partitions between the loudspeaker and the microphone. You can find a list of potential loudspeaker options at chamberreverbchallenge.com/createyourchamber. Just like anything in audio, don't rush this process. Listen, experiment, and listen again. As I mentioned earlier, the most common way to set up a reverb is with an effects send. This is superior to an insert in this situation because it allows us to preserve the dry signal and bring the wet signal in on a separate channel. An aux send is also a good choice because it allows us to send different input sources to the reverb at once. So for example, I could send a little bit of snare, a lot of lead vocal, and a medium amount of guitar all at the same time. The routing will be a little bit different depending on which DAW or mixer you're using, but the general principle is the same. I'll start by routing audio out of one of the physical outputs on my audio interface. You may need to disconnect one of your speakers temporarily, depending on how many outputs your interface has. I'll connect that output to the input of my amplifier or the input of my powered speaker within the reverb chamber. I'll connect the microphone to input 1 on my interface and create a separate track on my DAW to record the wet signal. Now I just need to arm the wet signal track and press record. The dry signal will play through the loudspeaker and the wet signal will be recorded from the microphone. After I've captured the wet signal, I can blend the dry signal and the wet signal together until I get the desired sound. I might even decide to adjust the level of the aux send from the input channel and record again. The steps in this video have covered the basics, but you can find additional tips and techniques at chamberreverbchallenge.com. Hit the like button if you got value out of this video, and subscribe to Audio University for more content like this.